Good afternoon, everybody. We are ready to start. So we are ready to start. And before doing that, let me give some technical instructions, because today we are in presence here in Aula Rostagni, but we also do have people participating remotely via Zoom or following via YouTube. And those that are connected via Zoom have the possibility to interact with us, to ask questions or share comments. And for this, you have a little button.
Sì, sì, sì. Un attimo, Giorgio. Sì.
For those attending via Zoom, there is the possibility to interact with us and formulate questions using the Q&A or DAR button that you should see available. So thank you for that, and let me then call Professor Flavio Seno, that is a director of the Physics and Astronomy Department here at the University of Padova, that will introduce us the event today. Thank you.
Good afternoon to everybody, either in presence or connected through Zoom or YouTube. Of course, it is an incredible honor for me today to introduce this meeting in which we would like to explain, mainly to our students, the reason why the 2021 Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded to Giorgio Parisi. Before going into the details, I would like to mention two points that make this award and the full career of Giorgio Parisi so extraordinary. First, here we are in the university where Galileo Galilei spent 18 years of his career, and where he introduced the scientific method and he tried to unify mathematics and physics. Now, 400 years later, we are on the way to unify many other sciences under the rigor of the scientific method. And Giorgio Parisi helped pave this road. He achieved multiple extraordinary results for which collectively he received the Nobel Prize. The most remarkable is probably the discovery of how complex systems can break their symmetries and give rise to complex structural rich collective behavior. To obtain this physical result, Giorgio did something unexpected on the methodological level, a bit like Galileo, and he was able to create a relationship with other fields such as mathematics, biology, neurosciences, and climate sciences. Secondly, I think that this is a true Italian Nobel Prize, as the one obtained by Enrico Fermi 83 years ago. Please do not misunderstand me. I'm not nationalist, and I know that physics is truly an international science where interaction among scientists of all countries are fundamental. But Giorgio Parisi is a living example that physics can be done at the highest level in Italy, and that Italy can be attractive for foreign researchers, as the many students postdoc of Giorgio Parisi testify. Let me conclude just with a special announcement. I'm very proud to say that just last week, our department board approved the proposal of assigning to Giorgio Parisi the Dottorato ad Honorem in Physics of our university. We hope of organizing the ceremony in fall as one of the main events for the celebration of 800 years of our university. But then let's start this afternoon by going back to December the 6th in Rome, in the Aula Magna of University La Sapienza. So just a second.
Per i signori, Sua Eccellenza l'Ambasciatore di Svezia, Jan Björklund.
Professor Parisi. The Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences has decided to award the 2021 Nobel Prize in Physics to you for the discovery of the interplay of disorder and fluctuation in physical systems from atomic to planetary scales. With regards from the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences and the Nobel Foundation, it's an honor for me to convey to you my my deepest congratulations, and I now ask you to step forward and receive the Nobel Prize in Physics for 2021.
Ok, Giorgio.
Eccomi, mi sentite?
Sì, sì.
Allora, io volevo, sono estremamente grato all'Università di Padova che compie adesso 800 anni, quindi è un'università non proprio giovanissima, rispetto a quella di a Roma è certamente decisamente più anziana, e per avermi onorato sia di questa conferenza estremamente interessante, conferenza che sono fatte da miei carissimi amici, e quindi che mi ringrazio moltissimo perché è importante dover spiegare a ragazzi perché la scienza si muove in certo modo, e poi anche spiegare le ragioni di questo Nobel che, come diceva Flavio, vanno indietro nel tempo e si riferiscono addirittura ai lavori all'inizio più di 40 anni fa, che poi ovviamente sono diventati col passare del tempo sempre più importanti proprio per il lavoro che è stato fatto successivamente, a cui perché si è visto che queste cose che avevo fatto sono servite come fondazione per altro. Ovviamente sono anche contentissimo della notizia che vi è stata appena annunciata del dottorato in fisica, perché effettivamente devo dire che io non ho un dottorato in fisica italiano. Il motivo è molto semplice, non so se qualcuno ha mai fatto i conti, ma se non so a che ciclo di dottorato noi stiamo, forse al 39esimo
o al 38esimo.
E quindi i dottorati sono partiti nell'82, nell'83. Io mi ero laureato prima e infatti non ho mai avuto la possibilità di prendere un dottorato. Mi hanno dato 3 anni fa un dottorato honoris causa in Spagna, ma in Italia proprio mi mancava. Quindi a questo punto posso dire di essermi dottorato in Italia anch'io, come tanti dei presenti. Quindi volevo ringraziarvi moltissimo e approfittavo dell'occasione per farvi vedere anche la mia tavola. Questo è dal lato di Nobel, questo è un lato più complesso dove c'è la scienza e la natura, e poi sotto si dovrebbe vedere anche scritto il mio nome. Quindi in ogni caso vi ringrazio tutti sia, come dicevo, per questa bellissima cerimonia che per il dottorato.
Okay. Giorgio, adesso abbiamo preparato, abbiamo chiesto agli studenti di farti qualche domanda.
Ah sì.
Ok, quindi invito primo, cioè, Lisa, tu hai...
Scusami, abbiamo... I have to switch to English now.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes,
don't worry, it's okay.
I would like to invite Sofia Moskin.
Good afternoon, thank you. I am Sofia Moskin, I'm a second year master degree student in physics of matter. Finding order in the disorder has been your mission in life. Usually following great achievements, we tend to underline the most beautiful moments of our path. But I would like here to ask you about those dark times in which maybe things didn't turn out, how your analyzing attitude was useful to overcome those moments.
Thank well, you. Let me say something. In some sense, I arrived to study disorder by chance in 78, 79, because I was interested in many other problems, high energy physics, deep inelasticity in quark and all that, the Altarelli-Previsi equation, and I was mainly interested also in phase transitions and in lattice gauge theory. So by chance, just because I was curious, because I was something strange, as was written about something that did not work, I started to work on disorder. Now you ask me what happens about a dark time. Well, I think that the typical things that I do, if I found some obstacle that I'm not able to surmount, to overcome it, I have often changed field. For example, I remember that at the end of 79, after one work or 1 year working on spin glasses, it was not easy to understand what else to be done. I started to work on quantum chromodynamics, try to figure out how to do computational lattice quantum chromodynamics. So one thing that I found useful was when something does not work, when you don't know how to go on, you can change field. Change field, not completely change field, because I mean it was always physics, but was a somewhat distant field. And I found that this was useful because after some time, I came back, started working on spin glass in 82. Some new papers were out, some new things were clarified, and it was easier for me to start to work on. And also sometimes it's important that sometimes your subconscious, I mean, you do not have, you start continue to think about the problem without realizing it. So this was something that was quite useful to me. Of course, in this way, there are many problems that I've not been able to solve because I tried many times to understand and I did not was not able and to change subject, but that's life.
Thank you, Professor.
Okay, and then we have Ali Reza Odakarimi.
Hello, I am Ali Reza Khodakarami. I'm a first year student of master degree of physics. My question is, have you had difficulties with your studying when you were a student? And what can you say to motivate us as physics students who are facing some difficulties?
Well, I remember that there was an exam that was that I prepared in too fast way that I have to repeat. I mean, people said that the examination was not good and that of course, what in this case I studied more deeply, and the second time it was the exam went well. Generally speaking, I think that The most troubles that may arise to a student are troublesome motivations. That is hard for me to tell how to put to fix them, how to go on, because if motivation is missing, it's not so clear what you should do. Maybe this is some advice that yourself is telling to you that physics is not a good thing for you, or maybe it just that you are too tired, that you are too stressed, and so on. I think that the only thing that I can think in such case is to, if you have problems of this kind, that you should start to speak with your friend, with other friends that are doing physics, to try to understand, to realize what's wrong, and so on. But it's difficult for me to do any general suggestion, because the reasons may be so many that I don't think that one suggestion fits. But I think that generally speaking with someone else is extremely important. I remember that when I was doing the work on spin glasses and many other works, I wanted often entered in the room of somebody else and say, do you want to hear what I'm studying? And that was helping, because speaking with people, telling them what I was doing, was very important for me to help to crystallize my thinking. And of course, very often the people I was speaking with gave a very useful suggestion.
Thank you very much.
Now I would like to call Chiara De Piccoli.
Good morning. I'm Chiara and I'm a second year student of a master's degree in physics. My question is, what advice do you give to young students and the researcher to be able to aspire to a discovery worthy of a Nobel Prize, not so much for the importance of the Nobel Prize itself, but for having made an important contribution to understanding the mechanics that move the cosmos?
It's difficult to give some general suggestion. Anyhow, in my case, the thing was full of curiosity. As I told you, I was not working on spin glasses, I was not working on the disorder system, and it happened to me to read a paper on branched polymer. I was interested in branched polymer not because I had any interest in polymers in themselves, but I was interested in branched polymer because there was a good model for interaction on gluons with a glue ball with themselves and so on in the confined phase. So the polymer were essentially some kind of scalar glue ball. And when I was reading that paper, I was I read a sentence that was saying, look, this branch of polymer we study using the replica method, but there is a problem in spin glancing which the replica method does not work. So I was curious about it. I was thinking, what a shame. There is a method that seems to be good, but it does not work in one case, and we don't know why. So I started to study spin glasses. And sometimes you follow your intuition, your curiosity. For example, one great scientist that I would like to remember is Miguel Virasoro. Miguel Virasoro unfortunately passed away in a premature way this year, the July of this year. And he was telling me that, he was very well known, not only for the work that we had done with spin glasses and together, but he was is very well known for Virasoro algebra. Virasoro algebra is one kind of infinite dimensional algebra, which is a new kind of algebra for mathematicians. And it was also extremely important for for all the development of string theory. And so someone said, but how do you get the idea of algebra? Well, he says, I was trying to solve a small technical problem, and just because this problem was quite hard and I need a new tool. For this new tool, I have constructed this algebra. But however, the algebra that is an extremely important result was just something that was done for another purpose. And also my understanding of Spinglass was done by this curiosity. So I think that the important thing is to follow from one side the curiosity, from one side look into the things you can do better. Because one thing that it is important, this more for people that are working on theory, that the people that are doing experiment, if someone else can do the same work that I'm working now, or in a few months later, maybe it's better that I start to look for something that other people is not, maybe is not able to do. So one of the things that was saying that I did not like too much to work on fields where there were too many people that were working, because I think that it would be more important for the science, for myself, to study something different. But anyhow, the study of Spinglass, for which I've been one of the main motivation of the Nobel Prize, came just by chance, and there was something coming from, I was not really any way expecting that it would be an important problem. It was fun to understand how things work and to fix something, but when did not understood at all that was an important problem. So I think that is also a problem, to one have to be luck. There should be some luck in order to get the Nobel Prize, because sometimes many Nobel Prize come looking for problems that they do not seem to be very interesting at the beginning, but at the end, you get something that is extremely interesting. On the experimentalist side, I think I can mention the Nobel Prize from the tunnel microscope. The tunnel microscope is an extremely interesting object which allows to us to see at a very detailed view of the microscopic world. And there was something that was done by the people essentially as a didactic instrument. And after having constructed it as a didactic instrument, they realized that working on it, they could go to some precision that was 100 times higher than what they had foreseen. So sometimes it's just some fortune, some luck. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we have a last contribution via Zoom by Giacomo Melaragno. I don't know, Giacomo, if you can open your camera and your mic, you can read your question.
Yes, good afternoon. I'm Giacomo Melaragno, a first year student of bachelor degree in physics. Your studies and research have demonstrated to embrace reality in various different aspects. In times when knowledge is strongly specialized, do you consider it necessary or even possible to seek for a unified understanding as it used to be for big thinkers in the past?
Well, I think that the amount of knowledge that we have in these years is increasing every year. So we have to do some to have a more specialization that we had in the past. On the other hand, I think that it's quite important that we have something that is not some knowledge that is not very specialized for many reasons. First of all, one is a researcher is going to work with 40 years, and it's clear that in a 40 years time, as a researcher, I mean, from 30 to 70, something like that, 20 or maybe more, 50 years. So a researcher is going in his life to change a field because it will be confronted half of the life with something that is very different from what they started with. So especially in the study, I think that to have more general information is very important. And also I have many students, people that got the degree with me, that got the doctorate with me, it changed field, went to field that quite far away. Some people went to understand the biological data, and therefore it's clear that to have some idea about biology. Some other people went to study economy. And therefore, I think that to have a certain amount, a certain attitude to learn different things is something that is very important. And also, I could not understress the importance of mathematics. I think that to have some knowledge of pure mathematics that is also maybe not relevant for the work that you're doing is something that I think that is useful. So I think that especially at the PhD level or lower level, it's nice that people have a general understanding of many, many different subjects, so that in principle, if needed, they can move to one subject or to another one. For example, in the 70s, it was extremely important the fact that there had been at the beginning of the 70s, a lot of people that went to high energy physics, to statistical mechanics. And after there was the things went in the other direction because there were a lot of ideas of statistical mechanics, for example, lattice case theory, Euclidean quantum field theory, and so on, that went back to field theory. So the fact that you have a cross fertilization between two disciplines, I think that is very important.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Giorgio, for your very inspiring answers. Hey. Now we go on with the meeting, and I will ask to Attilio Stella to give the first speech. Attilio Stella was one of the two students that Gianni Iona Lasinio had during his stay in Padua. Stay that was the big bang of statistical mechanics in Padua, I believe. Also, Gianni Iona Lasinio is another very important scientist from Rome that missed the Nobel Prize really for a small amount. Attilio then went to Belgium to obtain his PhD, and from 92 till 2 years ago, he was full professor of theoretical physics here in Padua, where he held the courses on statistical mechanics. His main results are in the field of critical phenomena, polymer physics, and recently econophysics. Moreover, he was my supervisor, my mentor. He will explain the contribution of Giorgio Parisi to understand disorder systems. Thank you.
Thank you. It's a great honor to be here in front of all of you to talk about the achievements of Giorgio Parisi. Of course, he got the main reason of this Nobel Prize is this theory of spin glasses, disordered systems. So we'll try to have a look at this in a short time. What is important to say is that apart from being a big breakthrough in the context of complexity in general, the theory of Parisi represents a very remarkable advance in statistical mechanics as a discipline. So I will be careful to this aspect in my presentation. So what is statistical mechanics? Statistical mechanics is just a theory which explains on a probabilistic basis the behavior at macroscopic level of systems constituted by many degrees of freedom on the basis of probability and microscopic structure. These are the two ingredients of statistical mechanics. Among the goals of this discipline, and the most fascinating ones somehow, are is the description of emergent phenomena. Emergent phenomena are phenomena like phase transitions, phase coexistence, which crucially depend on the fact that the systems have many degrees of freedom in interaction. And this many means order of Avogadro's number. The interest of this, of the description of these emergent phenomena is also in the fact that due to this probabilistic character and this dependence on large number of degrees of freedom, very often the mechanism which explain these phenomena are somehow independent of the substrates which express these phenomena. This is a form of universality. But let's go back to something which is familiar to all of you, I think. This is the phase diagram in the TP plane for a simple fluid, like it could be carbon dioxide, in which you see there are lines of coexistence between different phases. Like this line is the line of coexistence gas and liquid, or we have the line of solid-liquid coexistence. We have the triple point here in which three phases coexist. And there are rules for these coexistences. For example, the fact that you need to go on a line in order to have coexistence of two phases depends on the fact that there is an important rule due to Gibbs. Gibbs was one of the fathers of statistical mechanics, and he formulated his phase rule. Sorry, I'm clicking too quickly. Okay, so Gibbs, father of statistical mechanics, together with Boltzmann, Gibbs, Maxwell, van der Waals, Onsager later, and many others, they were all busy with this kind of phenomena, phase transitions and coexistence of different phases. And this field of phase transition went on during the whole 20th century up to our days and has been extremely active. And even very recently, say something like 5 years ago, there was a Nobel Prize to Kostelits-Taules for a transition, special transition, which goes under their name. But let's see more precisely what coexistence means. So we'll see it in the context of a ferromagnetic model. So here on the left, you have a lattice. At each side of the lattice is placed a variable, a spin variable, plus or minus one. M runs through the lattice. There are N points in the lattice. And there is an energy associated to each nearest Tibor link. KL indicates one of the nearest Tibor links on the lattice. And the energy is just minus J, where J is positive, is a ferromagnetic energy of exchange, and times sigma k sigma l. So this energy rule is such to make sure that, say, the lowest energy configuration for a link of nearest neighbors is one in which the two spins are both pointing in the same direction. So this interaction favors ferromagnetic ordering, let's say. Now, what happens if you introduce temperature? Clearly, statistical mechanics introduces temperature and thermal averages and things on which I won't go into details. But say, on the right, you have a picture, a snapshot of, of a configuration which is realized at T larger than the Curie temperature of the system, Tc. In this situation, the configurations which dominate the statistics are configurations in which there is a perfect balance between the plus and minuses, so blue and yellow. Whereas if we go to lower temperature, below the critical temperature of Curie, then you get something completely different. There are two kinds of configurations, disjoint somehow, which have a statistical weight. There are configurations in which there is a prevalence of plus spins and configurations in which there is a prevalence of minus spins. So this, well, one reason why this happens is, of course, the fact that at low temperature, the lower the temperature, the more important are the configurations of lowest energy. And clearly, for T going to zero, the configurations which survive are the ground states, the fully ordered states, plus or minus, somehow. Now, this picture is important to understand what happens with Parisi in a short time. But say, let's further show how one addresses this situation. So let's say this splitting of unequal weight between these two configurations of the statistical weight has as a consequence the fact that you express an average like this one, the average of a given spin, the full average, as the combination of two contributions which are averages restricted to the subset of configurations which we were discussing before. So this sigma k plus, average plus, for example, is an average of sigma k, but restricted to the configurations of blue type. Now these two objects are clearly one opposite of the other by symmetry. The point is that, so the sigma k average in itself is still zero below the Curie temperature. But the point is that even if there is this zero is obtained by a cancellation of these two objects, which are opposite and different from zero. So let's say below Tc, we have that sigma k plus average is larger than zero. This is very important, because it allows to characterize the two phases which are coexisting. So you see, for example, here, the parameters describing the transition are the control parameter, the temperature, and then this order parameter, which is just the average over all sides of the average plus of all the spins along the system. Now, this sigma k plus are essentially all equal, because for any infinity up to boundary effect, all these objects have the same value and are positive. And so they build up this order parameter, which is the magnetization, and which, by the way, was computed first by Onzager, exactly in a breakthrough paper in the 50s of last century. So let's see what happens if we introduce a disorder. I just changed the model in a way which looks very simple, very innocuous, but it is not. Say, suppose that now I assign to each bond an energy which is not the same for all bonds. There is now a JKL which depends on the nearest neighbor bond, and this time this quantity can be plus or minus J. If it would be always plus J, we would have still the ferromagnet we discussed before. But now we can have with equal probability bonds which are red and which are anti-ferromagnetic coupling, say. Now, in an anti-ferromagnetic coupling, if I want to lower the energy, I have to put the spins opposite to each other. So you see, we start having a competition. Now, this model can look like rather artificial, but it's not so much, because in fact, it's a classical model for describing magnetic interactions of magnetic interactions of magnetic impurities like iron or manganese dissolved in conducting matrices of copper or gold. So what happens if we have this situation? The thing is completely different from before. And the element which we introduce with disorder is called frustration. Frustration, we immediately understand the meaning of this word. Say, if I consider a simple case of just a lattice of four sides, a plaquette, with all ferromagnetic couplings, you see that it is immediate that you have the two ferromagnetic ground states. Here I have plotted the plus ground state, there is the minus ground state. They both have energy minus 4J, which is the lowest energy which you can get. Now, introducing disorder, like in this example, means that you are not anymore able to find a configuration in which you are able to lower to the minimum the energy of each nearest neighbor bond. In fact, you have, in these configurations, you can reach energy minus 2J, not lower than that, not minus 4J, and you have many ways to reach this value. The situation then is also occurring in a more macroscopic way when you look at a very large lattice with this mixture of ferromagnetic and anti-ferromagnetic couplings, because, say, in this cartoon, we have an idea what is going on. For example, you want to check how the total energy of the system, which is the sum of all bond and nearest neighbor bond energies, varies upon varying the configuration of the system. Now, in the cartoon, I imagine I am able to change the configuration by just moving on the plane perpendicular to the energy axis. So the energy in the various configuration is varying, producing an effect of a very rugged landscape. And this landscape has many minima of almost equivalent depth, and many barriers separating these minima. You see, it's very different from the situation we had in the Ising model, where we had only two valleys, two minima, very symmetrical. Now the things are more complicated. And let's say, by the way, to find, say, this minima in a big lattice is a very complicated optimization problem. So you can imagine that these kind of theories are connected with optimization problems, which are very important in most applications around. So let's see what happens if we... So what are the questions that people posed during the time Parisi started working on spin glasses, you know? He started in 78, 79. He was 31 when he published his first PRL on the subject. And the point was, what kind of transition do we have, if any, in the system? And which are the coexisting phases, if there are phases coexisting? And what is the order parameter of this transition? You have seen the case of the magnetization in the Ising model, that's very clear, but here completely, this is completely a virgin field on which Parisi started his action. Now I summarize the main ideas of Parisi's theory. They are, first of all, that to each minimum of the landscape which we saw before, there should corresponding at low temperature a different phase of the spin glass. For each phase, I can define restricted averages. You remember before we were defining the two restricted averages, sigma average plus, average minus. Now we have many, many, in principle, phases, and for each phase I have a sigma k average in that phase. But the point is now, due to disorder, the sigma k average is varying from point to point. And if I would consider a magnetization order parameter like this, I would get zero anyhow, even if individually these averages are different from zero, because cancellation occurs. So now, in order to better visualize what Parisi did with these ideas, I have to switch, I'm sorry for that, but I want to switch to a slightly different formulation of the model. In fact, it is the same kind of model, but say I want to have a visualization with the vectors which can rotate in the plane. So instead of using unidirectional spins plus or minus one, imagine that I have dipoles which can rotate on the plane. So this is and of course the interaction now is again this disordered JKL times sigma K scalar product sigma L. So again, if there is a strong, if they are aligned, they have a scalar product plus one, and you can lower the energy of the ferromagnetic interaction and so on. So what happens now? Imagine that this is just a phase, say a low temperature phase, basically a ground state, a minimal of the energy of the system. Okay? Now, the idea of Parisi is that since here we don't have the possibility to single out a phase by just switching on a uniform field like you would do in the ferromagnetic case. You know? In the ferromagnetic case, you switch on a little field and you immediately choose one of the phases according to the field you apply. But here, what kind of field do you apply? Because in every point you should apply a different field, in a different direction. So the idea is that in order to understand what is going on, you have to compare different phases. Here you have a phase alpha, here is another phase beta, they are different. In order to compare them, you could overlap one on the output, one on over the other, and you have this picture. Now, the idea of Parisi is that you should measure the similarity of the two configurations by just this indicator here, which is called overlap. Q alpha beta is just the average over all sides of this scalar product of the averages of the respective phases. Now, if this phase is very similar to this one, this scalar product is, say, at low temperature would be essentially one, and you would say, okay, you have a very high similarity, very high overlap. And whereas if Q is less, you have less similarity. And let's see what happens then. This overlap, which is one of the first ideas of Parisi, was discovered to be a very important, very characterizing property of the transition, because it turns out to have a hierarchical structure, very important thing. In order to give you the idea of what this hierarchical structure is, I have this cartoon here. So suppose here in this, here I have a set of phases, which if I check their overlap, mutual overlap of two phases, a pair of phases taken here, I find an overlap larger than Q0. Now imagine I introduce another threshold of overlap, Q1, larger than Q0. What happens is that this cluster is divided automatically into two subclusters. Within each of one, the overlap is larger than Q1. Of course, remains larger than Q0 only if I take one phase here and one phase in the other subcluster. And I can go on with this procedure. And what happens is this, that I can put several thresholds, and for each threshold, you have this kind of bifurcation, which reminds, if you look, a kind of hierarchical tree somehow. Hierarchy tree, in technical terms, it is called ultrametric property of the overlap. Now, in Parisi's So you see this idea of the infinite number of parameters, because say the idea of Parisi then is that once you have all these phases, they each pair of phases has a certain value of the overlap. There is a distribution of the possible values of the overlap within the system, and this distribution is the object which qualifies the order you reach, qualifies it as a quality, really, completely. And so let's say you, the idea is that then you have an infinite number of order parameters because before in the ferromagnetic case, you just have M of T, just one parameter. Here you have an infinite number because you have a function which qualifies the order. Now this picture, what was built by the theory in the years is a complete picture of what is happening in the spin glass, and this picture rests on two important ingredients. The results of very sophisticated mathematical calculations on very interesting models, but very technical also, and also systematic numerical simulations, also very hard. Because, you know, imagine what does it mean to simulate this overlap and so on for a system of 24 by 24 by 24 Ising spins. You know, there are many configurations to count. Okay, now I want to emphasize now the aspect of the innovation of this scenario with respect to the standard scenario which we were accustomed to during in the physics of phase transitions. So there is this infinite number of phases, not just a few like plus minus in the standard cases. There is no Gibbs phase rule. This is another important aspect. You remember at the beginning, I was quoting the phase rule. You can have only one point with three phases coexisting. This is not anymore the case. The rule here is that you don't have Gibbs phase rule. You can have, let's say, coexistence of these infinite phases also for generic choices of the parameters. And in fact, I found a sentence of Parisi in 2008. He gave this sentence in a paper in which he says that for him, complexity means that number of phases very large with generic choices of parameters. So this is his view of this aspect of complexity. Of course, there are other aspects which maybe Amos will talk about. But so what happens then this, with these ingredients in terms of this overlap and of proper weights P sub alpha, which you have to introduce, these are the analog of the weights 1/2, which we were using in the Ising case for the plus and minus averages to combine them. In that case, it was a simple weight, was 1/2, 1/2. In a case like spin glass, in the case of the spin glass, the weights are more complicated. Let's call them P of alpha. They depend on the free energy shape and so on. But then in terms of this machinery, Parisi is able to explain a lot of phenomena, puzzling phenomena like this one, which is the only one I want to recall here. So one quantity which one can measure on a spin glass is the magnetic susceptibility, which means I have my sample, I apply a very small magnetic uniform field on the sample, and I check for the magnetization which is resulting. I make the ratio between magnetization and applied field, and this is my quantity which I measure. Now, it turns out that, let's say, you can do this kind of measurements with different protocols. There is a so-called field-cooled protocol in which you go to the low-temperature region by already applying the field, and then you check the magnetization. But you can also do another protocol. I go to the low-temperature region without applying the field, I cool the system and then I apply the field. Now, these two protocols were known to give below the spin glass temperature, they were known to give very different results. This was a big puzzle, which I think is only explained on the basis of these ideas of Parisi about the phases, the replica symmetry breaking, and so on. So I do not continue. I just want to finish with quoting a sentence, a very recent sentence of Giorgio, in which I think you can catch the spirit of his attitude towards research and so on. So this is what he answered the question from somebody from the Nobel Foundation. It was an interview by phone, and he said the following, which I think is very nice. So I thank you for the attention.
Okay, we have time for a couple of questions, and those connected via Zoom can share with us your questions or comments using the questions and answers or domande e risposte button that you have available.
So, Attilio, do you have in mind one of these very simple model that can be the target for our students in the future? The one you would, if there are other simple models.
For target, for what, for some exercise?
No. I'm saying you were quoting this sentence of Giorgio saying that there are very simple. Have you in mind some other?
The simplicity of the model depends on who,
like Fermi,
who looks at the problem.
Okay.
I find the simple problems very hard in general, but.
Okay, I don't see questions live, and nobody wants to ask questions at this point, so I think we can collect them afterwards.
Okay. So let's move to the next speaker, that is Amos Maritain. Amos Maritain is full professor of condensed matter theoretical physics here in the department, and where he actually teaches theory of complex system. Previously, he was full professor at CISA, where he created the sector of biological and statistical physics. His main scientific activity is on statistical mechanics of out-of-equilibrium systems, with interdisciplinary application ranging from neurosciences to optimization processes, from ecology to protein folding. He will talk about the seminal work that done by Parisi on the field of complex systems.
Okay, thank you for the invitation. I would remember to the director that me too has no PhD, so in the future, maybe.
No,
because I started in 81, it was not yet official, but CISA was guaranteeing that it was equivalent, but I have not. So maybe
okay,
in the future.
Okay, so okay, next year.
Okay, so we can start from far away, from Boltzmann, that was leading to a shock in revolution in physics. He was proposing a new method, like Attilio was mentioning before, the statistical physics, and it was a revolution because statistical physics can't be derived directly from Newton equation. It was just a jump that needed some new hypothesis, and statistical mechanics was allowing to study systems with many degrees of freedom, where emergent phenomena that are not immediately describable or responsible, derivable from microscopic dynamics. And that was just at the beginning of studying complicated systems leading to emergence of simplicity from microscopic complexity. Then the big contribution, one of the big contributions of Boltzmann, because there are many, is attaching a meaning to the mysterious quantity that Rudolf Clausius was discovering when he was studying thermodynamics. So everyone has studied thermodynamics and then the concept of entropy was fundamental to explain irreversibility and in particular the second principle of thermodynamics. The first principle is comes obviously from microscopic equation, but the second principle can't be derived from the microscopic details or from the Newton equation. So it's really something completely new that can't be derived from rigorously from microscopic equation. And he was attaching a meaning to the entropy, and the meaning is simply that the entropy, it is a measure through the logarithm of the number of effective states in which a system can be found given some macroscopic constraint, like being composed of n particle in a given volume and with a given energy. So the entropy is a measure of how many states the microscopic state of the system can be. Then there's this beautiful statement by von Neumann that in the beginning of 50 he was writing, he was the project to write a book on the growth of evolutionary complexity, and what he said is that complexity would play the same role as entropy and energy in the 19th century, and that the 20th century was the century of complexity. And it's here where now we talk about the innovation of Giorgio Parisi. By the way, that one thing that I would add from the previous talk is that the energy and the entropy are fundamental to understand transition. Because entropy, energy, enter in the free energy with a temperature. They are weighted with the weight of a temperature, and the transition is where. So at high temperature is where the entropy is the dominant one, because the entropy is multiplied by the temperature. At low temperature, the entropy doesn't count too much, and you have the energy that dominate. And the balance between there is a temperature at which there is a sort of balance between entropy and energy where the transition occurs. So this is the big role of these two quantities, and especially the entropy that is also an ingredient of what Parisi has done. Because, there was an image by Parisi here and it disappeared. Sorry, Giorgio, but you should be here now on the right and you have disappeared. I'm so sorry, I don't know why. So he introduced this concept of complexity. So P of alpha is what Attilio Stella was just introducing before. It is the probability that our system is found in one of the phases, of the many phases in which a disordered system can be found. And so this is a sort of an extra entropy that has to be associated to the system. And it is a measure of how much rugged is the landscape of the disordered system. It is a measure of how many valleys there are in which the system can be found. And so this is among the various kinds of complexity that we can find in the world. There are technological complexity, biological complexity, there is a computational complexity. The one in statistical mechanics is maybe this one by Parisi is the first one which it has been given a quantitative description, which is just this one. It is analogous to the entropy of Boltzmann. And now it is has been generalized to complex system. So the impact of the work of Parisi is incredible because it has been applied very successful in many fields. I'm just mentioning just few of them. One is the content addressable associative memory that I will talk briefly in a moment. Optimization problems, for example, it is famous, the problem of the traveling salesman problem, where you have a given number of cities and you have a guy that has to visit all the city through the minimum tour. So this is a very complicated problem to solve. And this problem has been mapped
in a problem of spin glasses. And so the methods of Parisi has been applied to this one, and some partial solution that is better than the previous solution has been found for this problem. Not still solved, at least for what I know, but the methods of Parisi has been applied by himself also, and this is very important. Also, for example, if you have to decide how to decide the flights from one town, from a given city to the rest of the world, is a problem of optimization. Then there are applications to efficient algorithm in computational problems, and for that Parisi got the Onsager Prize together with Zecchina and the Mesard, two of his collaborators. Then there is application to machine learning that is related to the first problem of content addressable associative memory. Then there is a problem where we work with the director and with Antonio, who's here. And then application, recent application also to ecosystem modeling. Essentially, all problems that are characterized by diversity, meaning that there are systems that can be found in many, many physical situations, they can be addressable with methods of Parisi. Or if you are able to do that, it is already a great success, because you have bring the problem in a field where at least there are methods that can approach them. So, so the first one that I will talk, of course, because there are many of them, I will talk only on two, the content addressable associative memory and the other of protein, of the protein folding. So the first model is the one proposed by Hopfield, and it is the goal of the exercise that Hopfield proposes is, can I define a network where I can store in this network, for example, pattern like picture, like a dog, a cat, and a person, and then from corrupted, let's say, information, or if you want, not complete, no, yes, the patterns that are corrupted in some way, can I recover, can I retrieve them applying the dynamics in this network in order to recover the correct image? So the idea is that you have to formulate again a model like the ones that Attilio has presented, but where the coupling that in the model of spin glasses are randomly drawn from probability distribution. In this case, I won't determine the coupling between the nodes that represent the spin in the previous speech. I want to decide what are the coupling such that I can memorize in this network a given number of patterns. So the pattern are the valley. So I can have 1,000 pictures. Each picture is a valley. And the question that I ask is, can I determine the coupling in such a way that the valley are exactly in the corresponding to the pattern that I want to memorize? So the idea is the following. I have a landscape, which is this one, okay? And each valley corresponds to a given spin configuration that I have called psi 1. Then there is another valley corresponding to psi 2, and another valley that is psi 3. And I will memorize three pictures. This is our friend Samir, that is is online. So the idea is to use something that is known under the name of Hebb rules, and the Hebb rules is simply saying just choose the coupling between nodes. So it is again an infinite range Sherrington-Kilpatrick model, which is the one that Parisi was solving with this sophisticated method, is just to choose the coupling in this way. So the coupling are not random, but they derive from the pattern that you want to store. And of course, more pattern you want to store, more difficult is to retrieve them when you start from some initial condition. So if you choose this pattern and you have a given network with a given number of nodes, the n, the number of nodes, it is in the denominator, the number of pattern is just p, then what you can do is you have to define a dynamics and you have to start from some initial condition. So if you start from some initial condition that is not the original picture but is corrupted a little bit, and then you apply you have this energy, which is the spin-glass energy, with the coupling that I have just told you, and you define a deterministic dynamics, which is the dynamics that you would apply to a spin model at zero temperature. So you apply a zero temperature dynamics, and dynamics is simply saying that it is a sequential updating. So you update the spin at position I, looking at who are his companion in the interaction, and depending on the companion with which you are interacting, you change or not change the sign depending on the value of this quantity, which is simply the derivative of the energy with respect to Si. So if you do that, you can show that the energy is just a Lyapunov function, and so during the time evolution, the energy decreases. So if I start from this image, which is a little bit corrupted, sooner or later it will reach the bottom of the valley, again here and again here. So if you do this as an exercise, what you find, you can retrieve the information starting from partial information with this simple dynamics. So the idea of Hopfield has been developed in the recent year, and they have led to what is known as machine learning through energy-based model. The first one is a restricted Boltzmann machine, then there are generalized Boltzmann machine that take into account more layers. And what you have in this Boltzmann machine essentially is instead of having a network where all nodes are connected, they've understood empirically that it's better to have layers, for example, in this case, two layers, where you have an input, okay, where you can input, for example, images, and then there is no interlayer connection, and then you have, this is the hidden layer, and then there is a visible layer where you have the output. And there are only interlayer coupling, and the coupling just decide what is the energy of the system. You have a field, a sort of external field in the first layer, and the second field in the visible layer. And so you have the rules is to choose this field and this coupling in such a way that for a given input you can recover some information. Okay, so the rules now are a little bit more difficult, and typically they are determined empirically. You can make this machine to learn a lot, and then they can store this information. So if you introduce more and more layer, what you do is what is called the deep learning. And these are the great success of these models, just inspired by the work of Parisi with the many valley and disordered system, and the valley play a key role because they are taking into account the diversity of the system that has to learn from experience. So the next things where Parisi idea has a lot of impact is the study of the protein folding problem. The protein folding problem is extremely important because proteins is a paradigmatic disorder model. So protein are the molecule of life, okay? Everything that occurs in our body is thanks to proteins. DNA and RNA is important, but the major role is one of protein. Protein are enzyme are protein. They are helping your digestion. They are helping a lot of chemical reaction in our body. There are hormones. There are hormones that are protein, insulin, antibodies. Everything is has to do with protein. Tissue are protein, okay? Protein are essentially grease objects, and they live in the aqueous environment of the cell. So being grease, when they are created through the dogma of molecular biology, from replication to transcription and so on, protein are just the last result of this complex problem. And after they are created by this process, they fold in a globule where the force that is driving this folding is just to hide the hydrophobic part of the protein inside the core, exposing to the water the soluble part, which are the polar amino acid. And so that makes the protein soluble in the environment of the cell, and that avoids it also, if they don't fold correctly, to avoid the diseases like the formation of amyloid that lead to the Medco disease or Alzheimer. So protein is very important, they fold. And the folding occurs thanks to try to mask the grease part of the protein in the aqueous solvent. But what is very important in proteins is that they are done with 20 kinds of amino acids. There are linear chain where there is a backbone of the protein that can be as long as a few tens of amino acid or few thousand of amino acid. And the backbone of the protein is common to all protein. The disorder comes from the 20 kinds of amino acid that represent what is called the primary structure of the protein. And so we have millions of sequences of amino acid that represent the disorder, but we have only few thousand of protein structure. That the structure of protein in our body are the same as in a fish or in a plant or in a microbe. That we have the same shape of protein. Only the primary sequence is different, but the folds are the same. And the fold of the protein being very few, then the question is, what determines this fold? So one thought in the beginning, inspired by the work of Parisi, is that the kind of disorder, meaning that the kind of amino acid, decide which is what is the form of the protein in our cell and where they perform their biological function. Okay, but what has been discovered? Okay, let me. So this. So the energy of this of the protein is just now there is a matrix which is a 20 by 20 because there are 20 kind of amino acid. When the structure start to fold just to avoid the water, then the amino acid come in contact, and in principle you have a 20 by 20 matrix that is convoluted with a potential that depends on the mutual distance of the amino acid. So this is extremely complicated and not yet solved, at least starting from first principle. and then the hope is to find the how the state where the protein make its biological activity, how they form. So what has been discovered is that rather than as in spin glasses, where in the optimal model, where the landscape is sculpted by the disorder itself, in the protein, the situation is slightly different. And it's a slightly but important difference. And the difference is that it is the backbone of the protein, which is common to all protein, that is pre-sculpting the landscape. And so each of the minima correspond to one of the possible thousand folds that the protein can assume when they do the biological activity, with no effect of the disorder. So the disorder has no impact on the energy landscape. So the effect of the disorder, meaning that when you choose the sequence, what the sequence does is to choose one of these minima and lower a little bit its energy. So what the disorder is, it is just the address. The houses are already sculpted in the landscape, okay? And so it is a self-generated disorder, if you want, by the backbone. And what the amino acid sequence does, it's simply to give the address. So if I give you the address, meaning I give you the sequence of amino acid, so depending in which of this minimum there is the maximum barring of the maximum barrier of the hydrophobicity of the proteins, that is the house of the sequence. So for example, this sequence might not be so appropriate to this minimum or to this minimum, but it's more appropriate to this one where the amino acid in the core of the protein are hidden to the water. And so this is the picture that come out from in the field of protein. So in the case of the optimal model, you have to sculpt the landscape, like in the spin glass. Here, the landscape is pre-sculpted by the common part of all proteins, and the role of disorder is to slightly refine this landscape and to choose one of the minima. So this explains why, at least we think, explain why there are only a few thousand of geometrical configuration of protein, whereas there are millions of sequences that can fold in the same three-dimensional structure. So it is thanks to the Parisi work that at the end the community arrives, let's say, to this picture, and this is just the second thing that I've touched, and there are many others that would take days to explain where Parisi contribution was important. So really we need a special thanks to Giorgio, and there is this famous claim by Proust that the real voyage of discovery consists not in seeking for new landscape, but in having new eyes. So Parisi gave us the new eyes to look at the landscape. So Parisi has worked on bird flocks. This is why the... Okay, thank you.
Time for some questions. Please feel free to ask questions or add comments or curiosities to today's discussion. Okay, I don't see questions live, and we can continue and then.
Let's comment at the end. Okay. So, before I was saying that Danny Iona Lasigno had two students here in Padua, and Giancarlo Benitin is the second one. Giancarlo was professor of mathematical physics in our university from 88 to still 3 years ago, first in this department and then in the mathematical department. And he was teaching for many years mathematical physics also to physicists, especially to physicists, I would say. His research interests are mainly devoted to the study of dynamical system, of nearly integrable Hamiltonian system, and of Nekrasov theory. Today we'll talk of his scientific interaction with Giorgio Parisi through the Fermi-Pasta-Ulam problem. Take a second.
Thanks, Flavio. Great honor for me to be here and to have the opportunity to give this little talk about the scientific activity of Giorgio Parisi. It's also a little emotion because I come from here, although at a certain moment I crossed the road and entered the mathematics department. I come from here. A little contribution because the subject of my talk is very, I don't say minor, but marginal in the scientific production of Giorgio Parisi. Certainly, it is not the most important thing he did. Nevertheless, it is perhaps worthwhile to say something. For example, to show how different is the scientific production, and also to. This is something I like very much, to draw a link between Giorgio Parisi and the most well-known Nobel Prize in Physics of Italy, namely Enrico Fermi. So, what about the work by Enrico Fermi? This is, I think, the last work made by Fermi. Fermi died in November 54, the paper was published in 55 by Ulam, essentially. It's an apparently simple problem, as Attilio explained to us, in which you have, call it a one-dimensional solid, a one-dimensional crystal, doesn't work very much. And ideally, you have a chain of particles connected by weakly nonlinear springs. That's a trivial model, apparently. Just think the potential is something like that with a
a quadratic part and then some nonlinear corrections, just a series development, for example. And well, if the springs were exactly linear, then you have an exactly soluble model. You have the just a discrete vibrating strings, the usual normal modes of oscillation, or the Fourier components, if you wish, which are completely totally uncoupled. And so, if you introduce adapted coordinates, everything is just a set of independent harmonic oscillators. Let me say, as the zero order description of one half of the physics. A set of harmonic oscillators and then something else. the other one is independent particles. and so the energy, for example, is if they are decoupled, just the sum in suitable coordinates, just the sum of the energy of oscillators, and you have only some dispersion relation, which is important, but I will not exploit the importance now. The nonlinearity introduces some small coupling and possibly energy sharing among oscillators. You know very well that the one of the cornerstones of statistical mechanics is the principle, the so-called principle of equipartition of energy among oscillators. If you make the statistical computation, the canonical ensemble, microcanonical ensemble, doesn't matter. What you get is that in principle all oscillators should share the same amount of energy. The question is, do they do in time? If you give look at the time behavior of the energies of the oscillators, is it true or not that on the average, on a very long time interval, they do share energy? They exchange energy, so as at the end they have the same amount of energy in time. Sorry, this is called the ergodic problem. One of the phases of the ergodic problem, namely the interface between dynamics and statistical mechanics. Dynamical foundation of statistical mechanics, of statistical methods, a very difficult one, very difficult problem in general. Keep in mind that the nonlinearity depends on the parameters alpha and beta of the potential, but also on the energy. The smaller is the energy, the more you are in the bottom of the potential well, and the system appears to be linear. So, and the dominant term is this eta alpha square root of epsilon. Fermi, Pasta and Dulin made the first numerical experiment or numerical simulation of the story of science, just using the, not the first, but the second ever constructed computer, the first one with the von Neumann architecture, with the CPU and the memory and modern architecture of computers. A room full of tubes, sorry, and extremely slow. We have a description. It was capable to make 10 power 4 operations per second. Now, the worst of mobile phones in this room, which is probably mine, is 10 power 5 times more powerful, just to have an idea. And by the way, it was the first computer ever programmed to play chess. What did they do? They made a very pioneering work. They numerically integrated in some algorithm the differential equations, but just for a very small number of particles, and made a microscopic experiment. Now we call them molecular dynamics, for example, or numerical experiments. There are several names depending on where you live. What they did is giving all of the energy to the macroscopic scale, the long wave normal modes. This is what you do almost Every time you have a gas, you compress it with a piston, or you move a fan in the air, you give energy to a macroscopic scale, and then you expect the dynamics transfers the energy to smaller and smaller scale till the microscopic one. This is one of the basic processes of physics. And the question is, once you do, what happens in particular to higher modes? And the question raised in the paper is, how long does it take to observe this transfer of energy? And this was the question. This is written several times. And it is also written several times, they had a great surprise. It did not happen. It did not happen. This is RMAic, it's not the original figure, but you see, you start, these are the time average of modes. You start with all of the energy in the first mode, the one with the largest wavelength, and then you have a little interaction between mode 1, 2, 3, 4. You do not see raising the other one. Here it is made in, with a small nonlinearity. It's a, not large, but a time scale of 10 power 7 in some natural units. Don't ask about the units, in some natural units. This is the original figure in the paper. Times is 10 power 5. This is much easier. It's very easy now to make this a few seconds in modern computer. And moreover, if you look at the instant values, for example, mode 1 starts here, it goes down and again up, it goes down and again up, and 2 and 3 do more or less the same. You have a little decrease, but if you wait for a longer time, this was done a few years later, you see very complex, not complex, you have a recurrence. Recurrent behavior with several frequencies, but you do not see any tendency to really share energy among oscillators. Very regular dynamics. This was the problem. Only several years later, you see, we are already at 78, better computers, and only many years later, it was understood that if you raise the energy, and if you raise in general the nonlinearity, this is 10 times larger, the nonlinearity, then you have what Fermi, Pasten, Ulam expected, a fast convergence towards equilibrium. This is the energy of all of the 32 oscillators, and they all converge to the same value. This is normal statistical mechanics. This is normal behavior you expect. And this is an embarrassing situation. And a lot of people discussed, did work to understand, but so we have a threshold in energy, a threshold in nonlinearity. If energy is low, then we do not understand anything. If energy is large enough, then we have standard statistical mechanics. More or less, this is was the discussion, and it was called the Fermi-Pasta-Ulam paradox, paradoxical situation. Discussed among physicists in Novosibirsk, in Italy, a lot of work in Milano, pioneering work in Milano, in the United States. It was also very important in mathematics, because from starting from 65, very excellent mathematicians motivated, had interest, I think the main motivation, Fermi-Pasta-Ulam was the main motivation to study again after many years the nonlinear wave equations, the Korteweg de Vries equation, the one of the tsunamis, the Businesque equation, the nonlinear Schrödinger, which is extremely important now for the confinement, for the condensation. In general, the world of nonlinear integrability, solitons have been introduced just as a possibility to perhaps explaining what was happening in Fermi-Pasta-Ulam problem. So a lot of physics, a lot of mathematics. And 82 was a very special year. with two important contributions. One of a mathematical nature, exactly people who were studying nonlinear integrability, who made a connection. In mathematics, a connection calls a theorem, and even more, a theory, including theorems, a connection with a model which is was and still is a popular in statistical mechanics. It's called the TODA model, in which you have a chain of particles, but the potential between particles is a very, very precise one. It starts with the quadratic term, and it continues with exactly the series of the exponential. It's curious, then it is exactly, you can solve it exactly. There are many things you can understand. This was the contribution of mathematicians and the contribution of physicists in this very special year is a paper with Giorgio Parisi and a lot of other people. You see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 authors. And this tells you a bit of the character by Giorgio Parisi, because I was not there in that moment, but it was rather usual. The door was open, people entered, used to discuss, and they had ideas all together. At a certain moment, it was a good idea. Well, okay, so we can write a paper. All people write the paper. There is a kind of a style in working that I'm happy to remember here, which is the idea, the leading idea of the paper, is that the question, as it was raised, is there a normal statistical behavior or not? Below a threshold, not, above a threshold, yes. Was not the correct way to pose the question. You know very well that you start answering, you start understanding when you do not provide an answer, but a good question. And the idea is that, remember, we are in 82, there was a connection with the behavior of glasses. Not the statistical mechanics of glasses, but the dynamics in time of glasses. Glasses have very different time scales. If you look at a glass of the window or a spin glass, it has a configuration, it seems to be hard, but if you wait enough on a much longer time scale, it is plastic. It moves. And in this case, the essential idea is that if n is large, it needs to be large, and the nonlinearity is small, you have at least two well separated time scales in which different phenomena occur. This is somehow revisited. It's not exactly what is written in the paper, but it's a reinterpretation, a correct one. First of all, you have a partial equilibrium in which a few modes take part in the energy sharing, the other one do not, and with some exponentially decaying tails. And it's more or less like that. There is here what we have here. We have the energies, okay, in logarithmic scale, so a line means an exponential. This blue is the initial state. You give energy initially to one or a few long wave modes. And the idea is that first you have some interaction among only a few modes with some exponential tail. On a larger time scale, you have a slow, very slow progress towards complete equilibrium in which all modes speak to each other, exchange energy, and you arrive to equilibrium. This is the expectation, and now I show you a modern simulation on what they expected. It is rather hard numerically, This is a computation that we made about 10 years ago with quite modern computers. N is about 1,000. It's the minimum necessary. Initially, all energy is given to a small fraction of moles, this black rectangle. And then after 10 power 3 natural units in the system, not to be more precise, you have that configuration. Time 10 power 4, time 10 power 5, you see the profile, a very well-defined profile with an exponential tail is formed. If you wait again, you start observing the tail, which raises, it raises, it raises. At the very end, you get something flat. This is equipartition. So you have a first time scale with this energy, which is the same as the one, the energy per particle is the same Fermi used. The formation of the Fermi-Pasta-Ulam state, this one. On a second time, much longer time scale, much larger time scale, you have the raise of the tail towards equipartition. It's not difficult numerically, but hard. You see, this 10 years ago, this required, I remember, 2 weeks computation on 24 CPUs. So it's not for free. It's not for free. Certainly, it was impossible with Maniac 1 of Fermi. How they imagined. It was a simple and on the same time common idea. They replace the large N by a convenient continuum limit. This is what also mathematicians were doing. They do using what they were able to do, more or less as Giorgio Parisi told us 1 hour ago. You do what you are able to do. You do your best. They were studying, they were the experts of field theory, and so they made a one-dimensional theory, the so-called FIFOA theory in one dimension. And they interpret, this is the key point, the equipartition of energy among oscillator as a loss of regularity. This is just a didactic example, it's not a computation. If you take a continuum, this is an almost continuum, if you introduce just 20 Fourier components, it depends on the phases of the amplitudes, but basically you have some up and down like here. If you increase the number of Fourier components, the shape becomes more complicated. I'm sorry if I say trivialities, but you see, complicated and so on. Equipartition means loss of regularity. Analyticity implies exponential tail. At a certain moment, if it is analytic, in the mathematical sense, there is an exponential tail. If it is not, because you have equipartition, then you have a loss of regularity. So their idea was to study not the dynamics in a sense in the real space of the chain, but to study the movement of the singularities in the complex plane, in the complex X. This is the chain. They went to the complex, they studied that they discovered the singularities as poles, which is the dynamics of poles. Well, the dynamics of poles has two different timescales. This was their idea. And well, so in a sense, Fermi, this is not, this is a sentence by Fermi, it's not written in the paper, it's written in the introduction which Ulam made in the Fermi collected papers. There is his papers too, and there is a one page introduction by Ulam, and he says, well, Fermi was proud, was convinced this is a little discovery, and the universality you see of mixing and thermalization in a linear system may not be always justified. So, and In a sense, the suggestion by Parisi and other people is they are satisfied, but you have to wait. It's a question of time scales, which in some cases are very, very well separated. Time passed, and modern research, of course, for 40 years later, we do, you know, more. And the main point is putting together, if you remember, I told you that in 82 there were two key contributions, one from mathematicians, the other from physicists. Well, progress was made, at least for us, by putting together these mathematical and physical ideas, which is my job. The model studied by Parisian co-workers was the 5-4. It is not exactly the Fermi-Pasta-Ulam. If you go to Fermi-Pasta-Ulam, it's a little more difficult. Life is complicated. In any case, the basic idea that you have to look not at the, whether it makes equipartition or not, but look at the time scales is absolutely essential. And now we know there are several time scales, including intermediate ones. They are power laws in epsilon, telling you that there is some scale invariance, like in phase transitions, more or less. It's very important to understand the underlying total integral dynamics. This is something I'm doing in these days, I'm trying to do in these days. It's important to go to higher dimension, although even dimension one is not very well understood. A lot of people in Florence in particular, also in connection with Parisi, studied the non-equilibrium phenomena, temperature gradient, Fourier's law, and so on. And but in any case, you see the paper by Parisi and co-workers of 92 is really, in this field, is a cornerstone, a turning point. Thank you.
So time for questions, comments, curiosities. Your last chance. There is one question.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. Not a problem. Just one question. What is the role of chaos all that? Is that present? Does that change your everything or not?
So of course, it's a good question. If energy or nonlinearity is large enough, then the system is completely chaotic. Otherwise, you have a local chaos, which is not relevant for equipartition because it involves the phases of the oscillators and not the energies. And just a diffusion. If you think of an oscillator as a circle in the phase space, P and Q, then you have N of them and you have a torus. And you have a motion that is the equivalent in total system. You have a motion on the torus, which can be chaotic, but does not help for equipartition because it is only the phases behave chaotically. And you have a diffusive motion across tori, which on a much larger time scale leads to energy equipartition. This is the picture, the modern picture we have in mind. If you raise, so it is chaotic, but like a diffusion can be, okay? Without exponential separation of trajectories, transversal to tori. Only if energy is large enough, then it becomes completely chaotic. Always with some power laws.
Thank you. Other questions? Comments? So we don't have any questions live, so let me thank last speaker. So we are close to the end of today's meeting, but for concluding, let me share one last consideration or thought on the work of Giorgio Parisi, and also the importance of the prize that he has been awarded. And the thought is the following. We are all experiencing how today's research and science is more and more progressively structured and planned beforehand in order to meet the requirements of highly competitive evaluation systems. But the story that we heard today is a bit different. So the work of Giorgio Parisi has been following several paths, has been exploring several different ideas, and also led to results in fields that were previously unexpected, and in a few cases also several years later. So I think that this is telling us that one of the challenges of the present generation, but also the future generations have to face, is really keeping a balance between the demands from today of a well-planned science for success and also for sustainability, but at the same time, keeping a mind open, a free spirit, in order really to reach unexpected breakthrough and also new perspectives. So this is a challenge for the future generations to be faced. Okay, so let me then conclude and let me thank, first of all, Professor Giorgio Parisi for being with us today. And he's a great source of inspiration for all of us, and it was a great pleasure to have him with us today. So let me thank him. Then also let me thank our speakers, Attilio Stella, Amos Maritan, and Giancarlo Benettin for telling us this beautiful story today, and the students for sharing the questions with us. And then let me thank Sara and Roberto, our golden forces and strength for today's event. Thank you, Sara, very much. And thank you. And also finally, let me thank the University of La Sapienza for sharing with us the video material for the Nobel Prize Award ceremony. Thanks a lot. So then the last piece for all of us is a very short video presenting our science at the department, and please enjoy.
How many times as a kid have you watched the stars trying to unveil their secret design? Do you remember what you felt when you discovered that some of those stars were actually planets or galaxies far away with millions of suns? The amazement that struck you when making the needle of a compass rotate, it always returned to the starting point. Observing the things that you could touch, you began understanding the bigger things as well as the smaller ones, because watching is not enough. You must have eyes willing to see without prejudice. In front of the coordinated movement of a flock of birds or the synchronized motion of a school of fish, you get the feeling of a perfect dance. The movements composing the texture of this dance emerge from fundamental laws, creating new ones. We perceive the infinitely large and the infinitely small as elements of a reality that surrounds us. We study the elementary particles of the great accelerators, investigating the secrets of matter with refined tools. We pave the way to a new generation of computers. We scan the cosmos with telescopes on Earth and in the sky. We record gravitational waves and particles from remote places in space and time. So many windows opened on the infinite richness of nature. This way, we continuously redesign our concept of universe. discovering its evolution over time, together with the texture of matter, energy, emptiness. We cultivate our research with the same spirit as when we were children, but with the experience of 800 years of history. 224 people, including technical, administrative, and research staff, 6 degree courses, 16 laboratories, 1,711 students to learn about the universe. Be amazed again and always go beyond the wonder, the real engine of scientific research.